Okay, hello there, fellow students. I'm just gonna give it another minute or two in case anyone is still showing up. Okay, let's go ahead and get started. This should be pretty easy for people to jump into if they're showing up anytime after this. Okay, so hi, my name is Ajeet. I'm a master's student in math at Tandon, and I work with NASA Goddard on visualizing black holes, ray tracing around binary black hole spacetimes. So I do a lot of visualizing. So coding to visualize physical systems and trying to use the math of the system to make the visualization and the models more efficient and more true to the system. So, okay, so what is this? This is visualization through Mathematica. So visualization through Mathematica was a course I taught at University of Maryland while I was an undergrad. They had a program where students could make a one credit course. It's still going there. Some former students of mine are teaching it. So, if you wanted to see any of the course materials, I made a bunch of lessons. So it's, it's a full semester course. So there are 15 lessons on how to use different things in Mathematica. So this is the course website. You could also get to the materials by going to my website and then clicking on visualization through Mathematica, which will take you to here. That's the course website. Here's all of the Mathematica notebooks and the homeworks and the example problems and the projects and stuff. On a Google Drive. And then also on the course website are past assignments that students have made. Everyone makes a final project. So there's a whole bunch of final projects on there. So there's applications to biology, finance, chemistry, lots of different math topics, computer science things, and a whole bunch of other stuff. There's one on neuroscience, there's a Pokemon battle simulator, a huge variety of stuff. And then also on my website, if you click on this button, this is just a bunch of Mathematica stuff I've made, which, so what I wanted to do with you guys today is show you what Mathematica is and kind of how it works, and then go through some of the lessons from the course that I taught, just to give you an idea of what Mathematica can do, and then show you some examples. So just a couple things from here to give you an idea of, like what the code actually looks like if you want to make something. I think you might be surprised at how little code you need in Mathematica to make cool things. Okay, so interrupt me at any time if you have a question or if you want me to make something or if you want to see something, or you could send a message in the chat if you rather just type. Okay, so let's get into it. So what is Mathematica? So Mathematica is a technical computing language. So it's a coding language, but it has a whole bunch of math functions built into it. If you're a coder, it feels very functional. You can do scripting stuff, like you can use for loops and if statements and stuff like that, but it feels very functional, lots of nested statements. I routinely write things that have like 15 nested functions in a row. It's not really about how you compute things. The goal or the focus is on what you're computing. Up, let me admit somebody here. Okay, so and there's lots of very powerful mathematical functions that are built into Mathematica already. So so Stephen Wolfram, so the same guy that makes Wolfram Alpha, he designed Mathematica. It's the same underlying language. So the idea is you have all the power of a coding language, but with a whole bunch of very well implemented mathematical functions. So you don't have to import a whole bunch of Python packages, for example, you just have it built in. And they're all coded very efficiently. In a way that's useful to mathematicians, not just, like matrix algebra and stuff like that. You can do integrals and stuff, which we'll get to. And there's also a lot of visualization tools, which I'm particularly excited about and that I want to show you. So real quick, if you don't know what Wolfram Alpha is, this you should think of Wolfram Alpha as an application of Mathematica. It's a subset of what Mathematica can do. So here you can type questions in English, and then it converts it into, it converts it into Mathematica code, and then it runs it. So you can just type something explicitly like integral of x squared from x is equal to 2 to 5. Let me say integral of x squared dx from x is equal to 2 to 5. And it's computing, and this is online, and it's free. Oh, I have the pro for educators for some reason. All that does is unlock step-by-step solutions here. Sometimes you can ask it to like solve an equation. Sometimes it'll do like the integration by parts for you or something. And you, if you have pro, you can unlock the step-by-step thing here. But you don't need pro here because you can also do a lot of the stuff in Mathematica itself. And I think NYU does have a Mathematica license. I should check on that. But yeah, but I think NYU has a Mathematica license for the students that you can just download. Okay, so we see here, it wrote it as an integral here, and it did it for us. And then it gives you a whole bunch of other information. But Stephen Wolfram's idea with this is not just for math, it's supposed to be a computational knowledge engine. So his very broad goal for Mathematica is if humanity knows it, you should be able to access it through Mathematica easily. The idea, which, he's, working towards that goal. It's pretty good right now, but there's obviously lots left to do. The idea is to democratize knowledge, human knowledge. If science knows it, then you should be able to know it too. So let's go to the chemical weight of, water. Keep it simple. Chemical weight of water, that's not the right way to say that. How about molecular weight? Oh, I knew what I meant anyway. Okay, I should have said molar mass, right? And weight's wrong also, because that's a force, that's gravity. I should have said molar mass, right, of water. So here we go, great. Okay, I could also say something like, what's the population of Sweden? And you could do the population of Sweden and then multiply that by 7. I don't, maybe you want to count how many if everyone in Sweden had 7 apples and how many apples would be in Sweden or something like that. The point is that this is just the population of Sweden is just treated as a variable. And then you can also do, there's a huge reservoir of just data that is built into Mathematica. So stuff like here, so picture of Bulbasaur, if you're a Pokemon fan, I spelled that wrong. That's okay. Bulbasaur, great. Okay. All the Pokemon stats are built into to Mathematica just so that you can use them. Okay. Great. So right. So let's get to it. So So let me segue from Wolfram Alpha. This is being recorded, so you can go back and see how to do things. But also, if you want to know the actual controls I'm doing and the buttons I'm pressing, that's all in the notes that are on the course website and my website that I showed you earlier. So, So I'm not gonna focus too much on how I'm doing this. I wanna emphasize what you can do in Mathematica. So if you're so inclined to learn it. I think we have a chat. Can you send the link to website? Oh, sure. So, Ajeet Gary Home. Okay, so link to my website is in the chat, and then there's a button for visualization through Mathematica, which is the stuff about the course itself. And then if you follow the Google Drive link, you can get to all the materials that I made for the course. And then this is stuff that I've made. And then also links to those codes if you just wanted to like play around with like this planet model that I made, which I want to show you later. But anyway, okay. So where were we? Right, okay. So as a segue from Wolfram Alpha, you can do everything Wolfram Alpha in Mathematica, hitting control equals, shift equals. Oh, it's a text cell, that's why. Huh. There we go. Okay, control equal. So, so first off, it's a notebook format, which you might have seen in like a Jupyter notebook or something like that. So there's these cells. The typical cell is a code cell. You can just type code, but you can also make like a text cell if you just want to. If you want to like write up a whole notebook where there's computations, but also explanations and also diagrams and pictures all built in. And you'll see an example of that when I show you something that I've made. But if you hit shift equals here and shift enter in just a normal code cell, it gives you this little equals inside of a box, and this is straight to Wolfram Alpha. So you can type something like integral of sine x dx from x is equal to -100 to 345, and then shift enter is how you evaluate cells in Mathematica. And there we go. So we gave the explicit answer. Backslash n. This gives you a numerical answer. Okay, so there's the decimal. Okay, cool. So what can you do in Mathematica? Well, you can do math. So 2 + 2, and then shift equals, and it gives you 4. Okay, great. You can do more complicated math, 3 to the power of 7. You can do way more complicated math. Like you can just type out an integral here. So I can say sine of x, and I can say x from -5 to 5. And then, this is the explicit integral. Okay, so if you integrate, sine is an odd function. So if I did the same amount of domain from left to right, then that's going to be 0. Let's make this something interesting. Great. And then again, we can get a numerical answer. Okay. If Mathematica can't do an integral explicitly, it'll just do it numerically for you. If you want to do it numerically to begin with, you can use n integrate. And function calls are inside of, so functions, the arguments go inside of square brackets, and the and then sets and lists are the same. Sets, lists, arrays are all the same thing in Mathematica, and they go in curly brackets. Okay. So so the arguments of the n integrate function are the function you want to integrate. And then this little tuple here, so this is a common thing in Mathematica that you carry around these little tuples that that mean different things based off of what function you're using. So in this case, the first element of the tuple is the variable that you're integrating with respect to. And then this is the lower bound and that's the upper bound. So that's a common pattern is that for these tuples is that if there's like a variable that you need to reference, that'll go first, and then there'll be some numbers. And what those numbers mean depends on what the function does. You can see what a function does somehow. I forgot the button for it. Okay, so you can just start to type the function here, and there's this little I, and you click that, and it just takes you straight to the Mathematica documentation and tells you how to use it. The Mathematica documentation is fantastic. I highly recommend it. It's very clear. It's super easy to learn Mathematica, and even better than that, it's super easy to learn just the parts of Mathematica that you need for a certain project. There's not a huge learning curve. You don't need to learn how to do everything in Mathematica. I mean, you kind of just need to know how to use, I just showed you how to integrate, right? You can integrate in Mathematica now. You don't need to know anything else about it. Okay, so let's get back to this. Okay, so so you can integrate and stuff. But what's really exciting about Mathematica, I think, or what I want to focus on here anyway, this visualization little workshop, is that you can make plots and stuff super easily. So plot, let's say I want to plot the function x squared, and I want to plot it from -5 to 5. Okay, bam, there's a plot. And this is also a common theme in Mathematica. A lot of lots of functions have options that you can just like tack on to the end here. Mathematica is not picky about formatting stuff. You can put these options in any order you want. So it's not like Ruby or anything. It is pretty structured. There are rules that you get used to. But let me admit someone here. Oh, cool, great. So you can put these options in any order. So I'm just going to put aspect ratio to 1, which is exactly what you think it is. It just stretches this out so that the x-axis and the y-axis take up the same amount of space in the picture. Let me do image size and set that to medium, a little big here. Oh, I'm zoomed in up here to 200% magnitude, so you can see. Oh, actually, if I'm screen sharing, then I should be able to set this lower, and you can see just fine on your own screen. Great, okay, I'll set this to small. Okay, so here's our picture. And then let's do plot range, which again, exactly what you think it is, 5. So up and down 5. Actually, I can put this to medium now. Okay. So the, again, so specific syntax, check out the documentation. It's very clear in the documentation. But another thing with Mathematica is they like to be efficient with things. So you can, the comp sci way to say it is a lot of options are like overloaded. So you can type plot range 5 and it just does 5 up and down. You can do -5 to 5 and then, or -3 to 5. So this is a different format for the option set here, but then that means I'm going to specify explicitly what this and this is. Just typing 5 is the same thing as doing this. This is as a shorthand. And you can also go farther and specify the X bounds and the Y bounds like that. Okay, so -1 to 2 in the X axis and -4 to 6 in the Y axis. Okay, I'm just going to set this back to 5. So we have a square. Okay, so not hard to make plots. So notice here that these options are just formatting, making it look pretty. And there's obviously something to be said for making it look pretty. I love making things look pretty in Mathematica. That's that's kind of the point for, I think, for showing people these ideas in like a simple and clear to see way. And there's lots of other options you can add. You can change all the colors and the frames and stuff like that. But if we notice, if we focus on what the actual code is, or code for the math is, it's just this. It's just a function and the domain. And you can actually specify, so there's a subtlety. This domain is what you show and this domain is what it plots. Okay, so the actual math that's going on is just the function and its domain and then telling it to plot, okay? Let me just try something. What if we add a 2 here? So we just make like a steeper function, 2x squared, a tighter parabola. Okay, so here's the, someone left before the first punchline here. Okay, so the, my favorite function in Mathematica is manipulate. So you can box anything inside of a manipulate function where the first argument of manipulate is what you want to manipulate, and you'll see what I mean by that in a second. And the other arguments are these tuples with certain formatting conditions, which I won't go into here, but you catch up. I mean, you pick it up pretty quick. It's not too complicated. These specify what options you want to be able to move through for a certain variable. So instead of 2 here, I'm gonna pick A, and then we're gonna manipulate through A. And just by the simple little line of code here, it gives me a slider here where it lets me continuously change the plot function here. So it's all the plot functions with any A that you can think of, that I specified here from -5 to 5, defaulted to 1, whatever. And then just gives you the slider and you can do whatever you want. We can go farther. And we can say, what if we're teaching algebra 2 to middle schoolers or high schoolers, and we want to show them what all the quadratic polynomials are, all of them, right? So it's of the general form ax squared plus bx plus c. And then we're going to add a slider for b. Maybe we'll start that at 0. And we'll add a slider for c. And maybe we'll start that at 0 too. So we have a quadratic term, a linear term, and a constant term. And let me just show you another one of the bells and whistles in Mathematica, control placement. I can just stick those on the left. Okay, so then this slider controls the coefficient on the quadratic term. And that tightens or fattens the parabola. And if we push it too far, then it inverts it. And if it's at 0, then it's flat. And then this is the linear term, which let me talk about the constant term first, because that's just the y-intercept. That's easy to teach middle schoolers. But then what does this linear term do? Well, we know what a linear term does in a linear function. It's just a slope. But what does it mean in a quadratic function? Well, it's a little more subtle. We see it's almost as if it's shifting along itself, and there's one fixed point right here. I don't know if that's, what a lot of people would have imagined if I just told you, okay, imagine ax squared plus, x squared plus 2 and then plus 3x, right? What does that mean? Okay, it's kind of hard to imagine. I wish I had this tool when I was in middle school. That would have been great. Okay, so this is an incredibly general function. You can manipulate anything, any variable you can manipulate, and it doesn't even have to be through numbers. You could manipulate it through a set of options. You could, if you have some fancy graphic and there's a picture in there somewhere, you can encapsulate it and manipulate option, assign a variable name to that picture, and then you can give a finite set of pictures that you're manipulating through. Maybe that's not worth going into right this second. But okay, So, right, that's the main, and this is the main attraction here, is you can plot things, you can, you know, make pictures and graphics that are mathematically interesting super easily. And you have the, you can have the computations built into there. Maybe instead of explicitly ax squared plus bx plus c, I have the integral of this inside of here. Well, let me show by doing, okay. So let's do the integral of x from, negative 5 to 5. Is that what I want? Let's do, let's make a dummy variable here. So s, and then x. Okay, cool. So now this is the integral of this, and I'm actually manipulating the function that's being integrated. And we see in general, it's cubic. It's not all the cubic functions. It's just the ones that are integrals of quadratic functions. Okay, so it's kind of a weird graph, but I'm just trying to show that the these are the main three features of Mathematica. Mathematical computation that's easy to access and implemented well, you know, by smart people. Stephen Wolfram actually does something kind of interesting. He has this theory that everything is code. He thinks the theory of everything in physics is going to be a computation. So to that end, he's been searching the space of all possible computer codes. And then there's certain Mathematica codes where him and his team searched the space of codes that generate that kind of output and then selected the one that works the most efficiently. So kind of like a very abstract way of looking for efficient codes. But the point is everything in Mathematica is implemented very well. You can't see it, it's all proprietary, but you can use it, of course. But the Python packages, the well-established ones are implemented well, but there are limitations and stuff. Mathematica is very robust. It's rare that I find something common in math that, if it's a common math thing, Mathematica can do it. If it's a common graph, Mathematica has it. If it's an abelian group that you want to work with, it's there. So this goes way beyond just calculus. There's differential equations and there's linear algebra tools, there's geometry tools. Okay. So anyway, so I interrupted myself. The main three features of Mathematica is you can do intense mathematical computations easily in line. Feature two is you can make pretty things easily, like this plot, plots, and then we'll get to other kinds of things that you can create. And then three, you can manipulate through them very well, right? That's my take on it. Those are the three things that I find very useful. Okay, so great. Let's dive into some of the lessons that I made. I'm just gonna scroll through them quickly just to give you an idea of things Mathematica can do. Interrupt me anytime if you have a question or you want me to make something. Things are super easy to type, super easy to code. If there's a math thing you have in your head, I can probably type it down in less than a minute because Mathematica is just that efficient. It's very top level, high level language. Not high level as in it's sophisticated, but high level. It's not like you have to be sophisticated to use it. It's actually kind of the opposite. It's a high level language in that the functions are very powerful, right? Like writing things in assembly is harder than writing things in Python, which is harder than writing things in Mathematica. Great, okay. So, introduction and basics. I probably went through most of this already. So this is variables and arithmetic and how to use cells. And again, this is available on my website. So you have lists, you have a whole bunch of formatting things here. Blah, 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 Greek letters. We can do logic, trues and falses, ones and zeros, conjunctions, disjunctions. We can do strings. Something I really like about Mathematica is what's the comp sci way to say this? It doesn't type check. You can pass anything into any function. So if you try to integrate a string, it's not going to be happy, but you can try. In general, let me show you what I mean. So let's go back to this test window. So here's 2 to the power of 7 and it's 128. Okay. What about 2 to the power of, can I make an integral sign here? Integral and from 0. To, well, you can see that. So integral from 0 to 5 of sine of x, and then I think double struck x d is the differential operator in Mathematica. Let's see if that's happy. Wow, yeah, there you go. So you can raise 2 to this entire integral. You could raise 2 to, let's do something, let's do something weird. What was it? Shift, enter, nope. Option, enter, nope. I never use this this Wolfram alpha feature. So I always forget how to get it. How did I do it up here? Okay, you know what? I'm just gonna cheat and steal that and put it here. Okay, what if we raise 2 to the power of something weird? Picture of Bernie Sanders. Okay. Great. So where'd it go? Okay, so here's the output. Yeah, okay. So the picture of Bernie Sanders. So let me just prove to you that this exists. So what you saw there for a second is that Mathematica tries to get a sense of how things in the real world work. So it classified Bernie Sanders as a person. So a person is a type of Mathematica object. And there's lots of different people that are in that. It's like a class. So you can search for a picture of Bernie Sanders, and here we go. It goes to the Bernie Sanders and the person, and then a subclass of that, maybe an attribute if you want or something. If it's a class, then an object in the class. If you want to speak in like object-oriented kind of language. Mathematica is kind of like it's object oriented, it's scripting, it's functional, it's you can do whatever you want. But really, I wouldn't think of it as object oriented because me personally, I've never made my own object in Mathematica. I've used objects that they have, but I never made my own. That's not the point of the language. Kind of like they do all the work to make stuff for you, and then you use it. That's kind of like how it usually flows. So, right. Okay. So picture of Bernie Sanders here, you can just load that. And this is an object. You can do whatever you want to it. You can multiply it by 2. Okay. Apparently I did not expect that to happen. Apparently you can multiply, a picture by 2 in Mathematica. It just doubles the brightness of all of the cell of all the pixels. So I multiply this by 10. Okay, great. Okay. Apparently Mathematica doesn't have a coherent thing to do if you try to raise a picture of Bernie Sanders to the power of 2, or raise 2 to the power of a picture of Bernie Sanders. But Mathematica doesn't throw any errors at you because that's your prerogative. You can arrange things however you want. Apparently there's a way Mathematica interprets multiplying a picture by a number. So who is it to say that you can't raise a number to the power of a picture? So this is a silly example, of course. This is a practical example of how Mathematica is not picky about types. You know, like in Python, the pal function, you pass into it a number, or double asterisks, like 2 asterisks, asterisks, and then give it like a number, maybe even just an integer. And then right. And you know, if you do something else, you put a string in there, it'll be mad at you. That's probably why the picture was white. Oh, that's probably why the picture was white, because it's just too big. What if we do something subtle? That didn't work. Oh, okay. What if we do, good point. It's probably the picture, but what if we do something like this? What if we raise this to the power of, what if we square Bernie Sanders? Oh, it got dark. Interesting. Okay. How useful is that? I don't know. But point is, Mathematica, you can do whatever you want in this kind of capacity. I could put a manipulate around this, and I could manipulate on the person, and I could list a bunch of politicians in a discrete way, and then make instead of a slider, I can make it buttons, and you could click on a button. We'll see some manipulate options later. Okay, so right, so Mathematica is does not type check. So put things where you want them. Okay, great. Okay, having multiple Mathematica notebooks open at a time, I guess you can see here when I zoom up, so I'm sharing my whole screen. So I did that because I'm presenting, but in general, I wouldn't do that. So there's something called a kernel in Mathematica. It's where all the local variables are stored for your session, and it shares a kernel between all of your open windows, which personally I think is a silly feature. I've never once used that where it's nice to share a kernel between notebooks. Like notebooks are all, I've always had them be unrelated. It's pretty annoying because then they're all like competing for the same resources right now. But in practice, you wouldn't have a notebook about a lesson plan and then, you know, whatever this is, and also like this retrograde motion model all open at the same time. That's just because I'm presenting. Okay, so if you see it like pan away or freak out every now and then, that's a user error. That's on me, not mathematical glitching. I'm just using it irresponsibly. Okay, anyway, so right, so there's a whole bunch of built-in functions, you know, really simple things like square roots or power. I mean, there's, you can just use the caret for power, or even better, like you saw, instead of a caret, Mathematica also typesets as you go. So I hit control caret, and that, where is that window? This is annoying, hold on. Where, oh, yeah. So I hit control caret and just put it up there. And also I hit escape int and then typed int, and it made an integral sign for me. So I didn't have to type out the integral function. So it kind of feels like you're writing it down. Okay, so right. The, where are we? Okay, so manipulate, so you have sliders. List operations, that's okay, that's just like standard stuff, and the kernel. Okay, that's lesson one, that's the basics. And I told you most of the stuff in there already. Okay, so I'm gonna go through these super fast, because I don't want to show you how to do things, I want to show you that you can do things. So right, so defining functions, implicit functions, and table and map. Table and map, if you a table and map do the same things. I think in here, just to prove that point, I write table and map in the same way. If you've done any functional programming, you know what map does. It maps one function over a bunch of different variables or over a list. So like if you want to square all these numbers, then it'll square one and two and three and four and five and output a list. So this is what I mean by Mathematica is very functional. Map and table and fold are things I use all the time in Mathematica. To me, it feels like the natural way to do it. You know, there's no like right style for Mathematica, but I always find myself gravitating towards functional stuff. And implicit functions are very easy to make in Mathematica. It's not worth going through the notation of it with you here, but that's it. That's an implicit function right there. That's x cubed. The hash means give me something, and then the end means give me something, and the hash means that's the something, and then do a thing to the thing, and then spit something out. So implicit functions are super easy, or pure functions, Mathematica calls them, you know, whatever. If you, in Python, it'd be a lambda function. Okay, so fold, okay, right. So that's just, right, that's just what Mathematica looks like in general. Okay, let's get to plotting. So I showed you how to do a plot, but you can do other kinds of plots. You need lots of kinds of plots, actually. So here's a manipulated plot. That's the same example I showed you earlier. There's some options, image size, blah, 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 blah. As you see here in my in these notes that I made for the class, I show you a whole bunch of things. So if you're interested in learning Mathematica, I highly recommend maybe not studying these notes, but if you, I've become a Mathematica fanatic, but I've never studied it per se. I didn't like go onto the website and like go through all of the tutorials or anything like that. I just like, always looked up what I needed. And then, you know, you do that for a couple of years and you end up learning tons of stuff. So I would use these as a reference. So if you want to make a thing, just, you know, you can go to my website and pick the lesson and then scroll down and find the thing. But also you can go to the Mathematica documentation. I just have to organize in a certain way. Okay, anyway, so colors, textures, all right, manipulate options. So, other kinds of plots is a later lesson. This one's manipulate things. So we have sliders, we also have checkboxes. And we have multiple options like this. We have drop-down box. You can do combination of things. Mango, okay. The an input box, you could, so what if I want to, okay, great. So like what if, maybe I should do something better here. So x squared. So here it'll square whatever you give it. So I type something here. So how about 12? And it'll square it for me. It's a nice way to make little widgets like this. So so you can make little widgets super easily where you give the user. So I mean, what is a manipulate function? What's a slider? It's basically the user inputs some information and then the code does something with it. Like it's interactive. But this is a different way of being interactive, a more general way. Instead of a slider through a finite range of values, you can type whatever you want. So I can type 100 and then it'll square the 100. So I just like that, this little line right here, I made a little widget. And again, since Mathematica is not typed, I could put picture of Bernie Sanders. And yep, and then it does it. So picture of Bernie Sanders squared. So great. So super versatile little widgets are, you know, super easy to make. Okay. So all right. So a custom input function box. So that's that. Like it takes a little a little bit of getting used to notation to do something like this, where you're inputting a whole function, but it's not that bad. So here, so this is the plot, and it's just plotting what I want. So if I type sine of x here, and I'll plot sine of x. Cool. So that's just another widget. It's a widget that you could just do in Mathematica yourself by typing plot sine of x, but you can imagine a more complicated widget, something that, integrates a whole thing for you and shows you all the inflection points or whatever. And then all the user has to do is pick a function, and then it does all the stuff for you. But then the user has insane amount of interactive control. They get to pick any function they want. Or a picture of Bernie Sanders. Okay. So you can manipulate multiple variables, which I showed you earlier. That's moving that around. Okay. Yeah. Buttons are great. So you move the slider and then reset to zero button. Okay. So what is it? This is not a preset button. I typed this string here. That's what I wrote on it. Reset to zero. And I defined what the button does. You make arbitrary buttons. Great. Okay. If it's starting to feel like a video game, don't get tempted. I've tried to make video games in Mathematica. It's not great. It's not what it's made for, but it's good for prototyping lots of things. But all right. Anyway, so specifically, I tried to make Pac-Man on a cylinder. But anyway, okay. So okay, that's just formatting. This little line called a delimiter. Colors, that's just formatting. Okay, let's get to the fun manipulate functions. Okay, oh, that's lesson three. It's a one credit class, it doesn't move very aggressively. Okay, so computation. So I promised you two things now that are in later lessons. Different types of plots, which we're getting to, lots of different types of plots. And then other types of manipulate things. Actually, I showed you some of them. Actually, I guess I did show you those things, like buttons and drop down boxes and in input fields and stuff. Okay, so now I owe you showing you different types of plots, right? Okay, but we'll get to it. Okay, so computation. This solve function in Mathematica is awesome. Just like integrate and there's a derivative function, unsurprisingly. So just like derivative and integrate, if it can't solve something, it'll try its hardest numerically. But the solver in Mathematica is incredibly powerful. You can give it a polynomial equation of arbitrary order in arbitrarily many variables with arbitrary constraints, and if there's a solution, it will find it. It boasts that, which is crazy, actually, if you know anything about algebra or the history of algebra. So that's a huge achievement on the in mathematical computation, and in practice, it's fantastic for making physics models and stuff, because you don't necessarily have to solve a system yourself. You can just say, "Hey, Mathematica, solve this system of ordinary differential equations for me." There's also dsolve for solving differential equations, and there's ndsolve for numerically solving differential equations. But all right, anyway, so the when you're typing it, you don't always have to understand everything that's going on. You can tell Mathematica to do some stuff for you. If you want to, simulate simple harmonic motion with a block on a spring, you don't need to have the explicit solution for how the block's going to move. You need to have the differential equation for how the block's going to move, and then tell Mathematica to solve it for you. And you don't even need to see the solution. Very functional ask. You don't need to see what's going on under the hood. In something like Java, where it's this, then this, then this, then this, you see everything that comes out. In Mathematica, it could solve a whole function, a whole system of differential equations for you, make an answer in the form of a function, feed that function into a plot, and feed that plot into a manipulate function, and just give you a graphic with no other nonsense there. You don't need to see anything in between. You just get straight to what you wanted to, which I think is super satisfying. And I'll show you an example soon. Okay, so so you can do limits. Mathematica is not afraid of infinities. You can do integrals. It can simplify things like algebra. This is useful all the time for homework, like PDE's homework or something. You get this awful polynomial or rational function or something, and then you just ask Mathematica to simplify it for you, or rationalize or whatever. And you can expand, opposite of simplify, and numeric, just to get a numerical answer for anything. Okay, cool. That's mathy stuff that Mathematica can do. CS style scripting. This is just showing that you can do all the stuff. There's if, with switch, for loops, while loops, block and module are like ways to like make it look like a scripting language. I hardly ever use like loops in Mathematica though. Like I keep saying, it feels very functional to me anyway. But maybe that's just the way I use it, right? Okay. So okay, graphics. So other ways of displaying things. So I showed you plots, but we can also make. You can make anything you want, but there's you can easily make most things you want, and which is powerful. So you can make a point, make a bunch of points, make lines or a bunch of lines, make a bunch of lines in a star. That's just an example. You can make lines or dots of different colors, make a whole bunch of shapes. You can fill them in and make different colors. You can put text in there floating around. You can change the opacity. And then, you know, that's just like overlapping. You can change the structure of these lines. You can overlap things. It's a little bullseye formatting of text. And then you can do 3D graphics. So look how simple this code is for this thing I made here. That is, I literally just typed, where is it? Cylinder. So graphics 3D. So I called graphics 3D, and then I have a list of things to do. In that list, set color to magenta, make a sphere at 0, 0, 0, where the center is with radius 1, bam. It even has lighting on it, even has shading, and you can even grab it and move it around and twist it around. Change the color to cyan, make a cylinder. How this specifies a cylinder is in the documentation. It's pretty intuitive. It's the simplest way, it's the smallest amount of information you need to specify a cylinder, a right cylinder, an oblique cylinder, you have to add something else, but that's also simple. It's just overloading the cylinder function. Weird to call the cylinder function a function, but yeah, it's a function. You give it numbers and tuples, and it spits out a 3D object that all you have to do is encapsulate in this graphics 3D, and bam. Okay, infinite plane. That's the thing on the bottom there. Set the color to blue, make a cuboid. There's that cube. Right, and then the graphics grid lets you arrange things. Show lets you overlay things. This is a plot on top of a plot. This is a plot on top of a graphics. I graphics a circle, and I plotted a polynomial. I mean, let's say you were doing one of those classic like calculus 2 high school kind of problems where you wanted to find the maximum of something on a boundary, but the boundary is a circle and the function is a polynomial. Polynomials are nice to plot. Circles are not nice to plot. I mean, obviously the circle here isn't even a function. It doesn't pass vertical line test. So you have to plot it. You have to plot it in two pieces, but then it blows up towards zero. But I mean, you can just graphics a circle and then literally overlay it on top of the plot. Great. Okay, that's graphics. You make a whole bunch of shapes and stuff. Again, if you have any requests or something, a question about something you can make, the answer is yes, I can make it. And then I can show you how. Okay. All right, other kinds of plots, region plots. You can shade things in really easily. This is nice for one of those classic like calculus problems, like, oh, what is the area of this bounded of the region bounded by these lines. You could just draw the lines with shading, and then bam, the region plot would show you what's up. This is a circle that I just filled in. This is just two parabolas. This is a bunch of overlapping ones. This is something weird. This weird function here, prime q floor x times y. That's, you know, showing you can do, you can get really complicated. I sound like Stephen Wolfram. Okay. You can create very complicated code, very complicated programs with very simple code. That's straight out of Stephen Wolfram's like manifesto, A New Kind of Science. So if you know anything about Stephen Wolfram, he's cellular automata, something he's really interested in, like John Conway's like Game of Life and stuff like that. Like, simple codes that can generate huge things, sometimes even be Turing complete, which means they can compute anything. So this is an example of that. Very simple code, very complicated output here. Okay, so right, the concentric circles. Okay, contour plot, I really like this one. So think calculus 3, level sets. This is a level set of this function. So this function is a cone, and then equals 2, the level set is a circle. You could put a stick and manipulate on that. So let's look at this guy here. This shape is a hyperboloid. And if we, we're gonna do the contour of when it equals to C and manipulate on C, and we see all the cross sections of the hyperboloid. Cool. So this would be good again for algebra 2, for conic sections, to see those level sets, see how all the different conic sections come out of planes intersecting a cone. you could draw a bunch of the contours at once. That was pretty. Let's see if I can get the X. Maybe I lied to you. Maybe this isn't hyperboloid. Maybe this is a, well, maybe that's a type of hyperboloid. I think this is a hyperbolic paraboloid, actually. This is a, it's a Pringles chip. It's a saddle. Yeah, okay, cool. The, right, it's a quadrupole, if you like electricity and magnetism. Great, okay. Right, so colors, that's pretty. You need density plots, okay. The, this is one of my, this is my favorite application of the contour plots here. This is the phase space for simple harmonic motion. And each contour represents a certain energy of a spring in simple harmonic motion, for example. Or a block on a spring, for example. Okay, it's a different level sets there. The little symplectic geometry, light symplectic geometry. Okay, the density plots. Okay, cool. Those, that's we're just scratching the surface of plots you can make in Mathematica. So if you can read this, that was plotting two. All right, let's go to plotting three. How are we doing on time? Okay, so I'll have time at the end to show you like one example that I made. It's like a fun like physics project. I make physics things a lot, but okay. Polar plot, you can plot in polar coordinates. Here's a flower. I'm manipulating on, I'm manipulating. So if you've ever seen a polar flower before, the number of petals is controlled by N here in the argument of sign. And actually it's the parity of N, like odd or even is very important. But I just put a manipulate over N. So then I just see what happens at 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Again, high school algebra, middle school algebra, this has been awesome to see things. Trig, I think, is when we talk about polar plots. Oh, that makes sense. The first time when I learned it in like high school or whatever, this would have been awesome to get your head around it. Okay, the more polar plots. Okay, parametric plot. I love parametric plot. Parametric plot. So what's a parametric curve? A parametric curve is a curve in, you know, one, two, or three dimensions. Well, let's say two or three dimensions. That's specified by one variable, one parameter. So like a line in two space or three space is really just defined, it is really, you know, a one-dimensional object. So in principle, you can parameterize it with just one parameter S. So parametric plot lets you draw like arbitrary curves very well. And I feel like parameterizing things, I think, is very fun because it gives you a really good sense of what's going on. Okay, so these are just examples of parametric curves, and you can do parametric plot 2D. You can parameterize a curve with two variables. You can also parameterize three-dimensional things with two variables. So a fun little project if you're ever bored on a rainy Sunday. So think about like a torus or a donut, for example, right? A donut. What is a donut? It's like a circle that's revolved around some center. It's like a tube that's wrapped around itself. It's a two-dimensional shape. So in principle, you could parameterize it with two variables, but it lives in three-dimensional space. Can you think of a way to make a torus or a donut in three-dimensional space, just describing it with two variables? So in other words, can you describe it as a surface that's a function of two variables, and those two variables are over a certain domain? So like I could describe this ring here using an r and a theta. The r goes from maybe 2 to 3, and the theta goes from 0 to 2 pi, bam. That's a ring. Can you think of a similar thing using two variables in three-dimensional space? Or so maybe like x, you know, maybe you want to use r, phi, and theta in three-dimensional space and have those be functions of two parametric variables, s and t. Okay, anyway, I'm going into teacher mode. I need to move on with Blitz Mathematica, show you a bunch of stuff. Okay. What was I gonna say? Right, cool. So here's plot 3D. You can plot 3D shapes. And again, you can grab and move things around in 3D. This is a saddle. Cool, or a Pringles chip. Hyperbolic paraboloid. Ah, that's what I said before. Okay, good. This is just something weird, sine of X, Y. Ah, that's strange. And then I just, plot style, I just made light green is just a preset. And apparently this is what happened. This is, I don't know how that's light green, I guess with the coloring. Mathematica pretends there's like a light bulb up here or something. So there's some shading and you can change what this mesh looks like. I turned on all the mesh lines so you can kind of see how Mathematica computed this, and you see it's like, it gets very complicated right there, but it's very simple right here. It's a triangulation of the surface. That's how Mathematica draws all these things. Well, that's how most things draw most things, is triangulating. But anyway, here's a bunch of delta functions. They're tangent functions, but they look like delta functions, approximating delta functions. Contour plot 3D. So contour plot 3D. Ah, geez, I'm going way too in depth on everything. fine, I'll skip it. Okay, no, I won't. Okay, so you can have a three, you can have a two-dimensional surface in three space, and you can take level sets of it, which look like these two-dimensional curves. Well, what if you have a function of three variables? So like maybe the temperature in this room. So that's a function that's defined at every x, y, and z coordinate in the whole room. And then I take two-dimensional level sets of that. So like, let's say the level set where the temperature is equal to 20 degrees, that's too cold, equal to 60 degrees Fahrenheit, which should be a continuous surface because we posit that the temperature in this room is continuous. So then it would just be some two-dimensional surface floating in three space. So like here's an example of what if you just take a whole bunch of concentric spheres. This is less cool than it looks. It's just a bunch of concentric spheres and then cut off in this like this plot range box. But okay, anyway, contour plot 3D is fun. Oh, this is something for one of my topology research projects. Okay, this is I cannot go into that right now. Okay, this is a spiral. This is a spiral hit with a transformation matrix. So this is an example of, in Mathematica, using all your mathematical tools built into coding. So here I'm using trigonometric functions and I'm plotting them with Mathematica's awesome tools and giving some sliders to manipulate. And then I'm rotating them with rotation matrices. I literally just multiply. And then if I change the parameters in the rotation matrix, the theta and the phi here, it corresponds to rotating this guy. And at first glance, it might seem kind of crazy that it can compute this in real time like this, but I mean, this computation actually isn't that big. If you can do it 20 times per second, that updated 20 times per second, then it can fool your eye and think it's continuous, right? Okay. So if you have a really big computation here, then it's harder to do this smoother, but you can do, pretty powerful, big computations here and still get nice smooth models like this. Okay, this is just an example of parameterizing in two variables. Oh, punchline, here's the, this is how to do the torus. Okay, anyway, moving on. All right, what else we got? Manipulate two. Oh, I thought I already did manipulate. Oh, wow, there's more manipulate. I forgot, there's locators. Ah, okay. You can have a locator. So this is a type of manipulate. Manipulate is interactive stuff. This is another type of interactive stuff. You can grab these. You can add more points too. Where did I? These are just little examples. Okay. You can add more points. Okay, I'll get to it eventually. So this is a Lagrange interpolation. So you pick three points in the plane and it, and then using this solve function here, I literally just barbarically solved for what polynomial fits in these three points, which is the Lagrange interpolation. If you were to do this, and with fancy math, and then bam, so you just pick three points in the plane and it'll give you this, this parabola here. This is just a little color example, whatever. Okay, to auto create. Okay, great. You can add points. Okay, I really like this one. This one is like the Lagrange interpolation. So you pick arbitrarily many points in the plane, and then it gives you a polynomial of degree one less order, the unique polynomial of degree one less order that fits those points. So you can move these around, and you can take a point away, and you can add points, and it'll do what it does. And the code for it is just this, and lots of that is just cosmetic, aspect ratio, plot range, image size, and then here's the manipulate options. And then this is the actual math. That little line of code makes an arbitrary Lagrange interpolation widget. Okay, I really like that one. Dynamic is a whole thing, not getting into that. Okay, so the parallelization, oh great, and now we're in the advanced topics for the last couple weeks of the class. So we can avoid going into those. Let's see, we got 6 minutes left. So, what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna go back to my website and I'm going to scroll through this portfolio. And if anyone sees something they want me to show them the actual model of, then type it in the chat or unmute yourself and say so. If not, I'm going to spend the last like 4 minutes on I think probably my favorite model I've made in Mathematica, retrograde motion, which is the planet orbit thing. Okay, so these are just the things that, just a couple of things that are pretty to look at. So this is a Taylor expansion widget. This is a retrograde motion. This is special relativity, the barn ladder paradox. That's a whole thing. I keep meaning to turn this into a YouTube video. This is relativistic beaming. That's a general relativity thing. Sorry, it's a special relativity thing, actually. Okay. This is where quasars come from. This is a fractal. The code for this fractal is so small, which is surprising because fractals, it may be surprising because fractals have infinite complexity. But all right, so this is a geosynchronous orbit, more physics stuff, orbital mechanics. This is quantum mechanics, infinite square well. This is like the wave function of a particle looks like inside of a well. This is a 2D perceptron if you're a comp sci person. This is a little geometry. Did you know that using Euclidean geometry techniques of a ruler and a compass, you can create a line segment that is the length of the square root of any integer? So can you trisect a line? No. But can you create something that is, if you have a unit, if you have one thing that is, Greek stick in length, can you make something that is root 17 Greek sticks in length? Yes, you can construct that, and this is a construction. And again, the code is so simple, and it's so satisfying too. In Mathematica, the person who taught me, taught me how to start using Mathematica, he told me, if you can't figure out how to do it simply, please don't do it in Mathematica, because there's always a really like elegant way to do it. Sometimes you go all the way back to the math, and you figure out at its core, what's the mathematical structure going on? And then you code that. It's a really good instructional tool. If you can, a lot of times trying to understand a physical system, I'm trying to make it in Mathematica, and then I figure out it's a simpler system than I thought it was when I go to actually try to code it down. Coding things down in Mathematica, I think, is a great way to learn math and physics, because it really helps you get to the root of what is the computation and what is the interesting behavior. But okay. Curve homotopy. This is just little topology. This is just morphing a curve into another curve. And braid group visualizer. This is for so topological quantum computing does this really trippy thing where they you can create qubits by tangling the world lines of particles. So this is the mathematics behind that. Well, part of the mathematics behind that. Okay, I don't see any requests in the chat, so I'm going to spend the last 3 minutes to show you. Actually, this one's quick. This is superposition of waves. If you're a music person, overtones, that's an overtone. So here's the big wave, and here's the little wave, and then here's the compound wave, which is a wave with an overtone. Okay, cool. All right, anyway, so retrograde motion. So what's retrograde motion? Okay, so retrograde motion. So we used to think that the sun went around the earth and everything went around the earth. Just looking at the sun, it's plausible. And look at the other planets on first glance, it's plausible. Except for the first one problem, anyway. The first one that people notice, every now and then in the sky, in the night sky, on one night, or for a couple nights in the year, Mars doesn't move across the sky as if it's rotating around us. It goes backwards and then goes forwards again. It's called retrograde motion, retro motion. So just going backwards. If everything revolves around the Earth, because the Greeks thought God created Earth and all that stuff, and then humans are special and all that, then how would you explain Mars going backwards? Well, you couldn't, right? So like orbiting, Earth doesn't just start going backwards around the sun every now and then continue on its path. So they tried to explain this with epicycles, so circles around, orbits around, orbits around, orbits. Maybe the Mars was a moon around something that's orbiting around Earth. Or orbiting around something that's orbiting around something that's orbiting around Earth, but none of that worked. And so Copernicus figured out, yeah, I have a better idea. Maybe everything goes around us. And they killed him for that, but he's a heretic, but it turns out he was right. So I didn't understand this. I didn't understand why Mars would appear to go backwards in our sky. It's not that I didn't believe it, just I didn't understand it. So I wanted to see it, but I didn't want to artificially program it, because there's no point in that. So what I did is I coded this here, as you evolve time. Okay, so as you evolve time here, the Earth here will go around the sun, and Mars will also go around the sun. These lines are purely just for visual. They're not doing anything. Not to scale, obviously. I can put the moon in here too. The years and days, the years aren't to scale either. But anyway, so the Earth goes around the sun, Mars goes around the sun, and moon goes around Earth, but the moon's irrelevant here. Except as a point of reference of something that really does move circularly in the sky, as if it's orbiting us, center of the universe. So then, right. So what I did here is I coded the physical system, and then I just did a mathematical projection onto what the sky would look like. And then we're going to see here that we actually do see the behavior, which I think is way more satisfying than just like hard coding retrograde motion, where, you know, we're making a model of the universe and rediscovering it. Okay. So, so if you can see here, let me zoom in just a little bit. Okay. So this is the code for it, by the way. So much of this is cosmetic. So much of this is just making these little balls and these little lines and stuff like that. The actual math is just this. It's just using parametric stuff. It's super easy to do the math, actually. So once you get used to Mathematica, this is not complicated to make, even though it looks like a whole thing. So as I move time here, let me move a little bit so things aren't overlapping. This is the horizon. Don't worry about that. Or it's not relevant here. This is the sun, that little yellow dot that I should change the color of. This gray thing is the moon, and this red thing is Mars. So let's, there's another feature of Mathematica I didn't show you before. You can hit play on this, and they can play themselves. Slow down, Mathematica, slow. Oh my God. Okay, it's lagging because I'm also in Zoom, so it doesn't want to slow down. Oh man, I've really made it mad now. Jeez. Okay, not great. All right, so in Mathematica, what we do when we screw things up is we quit the kernel, which I can't do that right now either. All right, I'm going to force quit Mathematica. yep, that's on me. Can you plot the Mandelbrot set? Oh, such a good question. yes, we can. I have that. Since I crashed the thing I was trying to show you, I can show you the Mandelbrot set instead. Mandelbrot set, this one was fun. I don't think I did it very efficiently at all. I just did it very brute force. For those YouTube videos you see of like zooming in super far on the Mandelbrot set, those people are doing this in a way more clever way. Oh, you also grab this and show you that and just drag it. Here's Mandelbrot set. Iteration 13, iteration, oh geez, what does the slider even do? Okay. It's a fractal. So these are in some sense the steps of the fractal. Oh, why would I slide that like that? Bad idea. All right, 17 steps. There's some structure, 18 steps. Ah, geez, it's computing. So this innocuous little slider here, I broke it. this innocuous little slider here is asking my code, my very simple, very brute force little Mandelbrot set code here to do 18 iterations of this. So there's 17. I hope that looks like the Mandelbrot set to you. Let's try one more time. 18, you can do it. You can do it, Mathematica. I believe in you. You can increase computation time, but I also don't want to piss off my computer. Okay, so let's head back to retrograde motion real quick. Retrograde motion. I have one called finished. I should do that one. Finished, great. Precursor to heliocentrism, word. Okay, cool. So I'm gonna manually slide this very slowly. Okay, so yellow dot is the sun, gray dot is the moon, and red dot is Mars. And maybe I should fix it at midnight. I will fix it at midnight. Why am I fixing it at midnight? I'm fixing it at midnight because, I'm trying to do this fast. Okay, whatever. Okay, so just watch these move in the sky. Okay, so you'll notice that the moon follows a nice circular orbit around the sky. This is only choppy because the slider. I can only slide so slowly. It's not discretized or anything. It's the math is continuous. So the moon really does move around us in a circle. So it definitely has to go in a circle in the sky. All right, let's watch the yellow dot for the sun. So we go around the sun, but it's actually in the sky, it looks the same. So that goes around a circle also. So the two most important things are the sky, the two biggest things, the sun and the moon, both go around us. So maybe it was reasonable for the Greeks to think that we're the center of the universe. We're also the smartest things on this planet. And so, everything else is just like a squirrel or a rock or a tree. So, and everything seems to revolve around us, even the stars. So, wow, so maybe we are the center of the universe. Okay, But now let's watch Mars. Okay. So Mars is going nice in a circle, like everything else. A little slower, that's fine. Everything orbits around the Earth. We're the center of everything, you know? But everything doesn't have to orbit at the same speed. Okay. So there goes Mars. It's going around. Cool. We are the gods of this world. What is that? It's going backwards. I know. Maybe we shouldn't have killed Copernicus. Okay. No one saw that, right? All right. So the Greeks can't deny that Mars went backwards on their sky. That's not good. That means that our whole geocentrism thing can't be right. They tried very hard at the math because they really wanted to believe that the center of everything. The Greeks that had their math and their religion and their politics and their philosophy all wrapped up together. You know, they're very rational about some things like, you know, constructions, you know, the birth of geometry in the dirt. But also, that was an awesome insight, but they also thought there's an anti-Earth on the other side of the sun. They didn't really know anything. So that's speculated about some things, but anyway. And all got wrapped up together. But all right, anyway, so let's figure out what retrograde motion is doing. So we saw Mars go backwards in the sky. And if the Greeks had Mathematica, they could see on the left-hand side what's actually happening. So why does retrograde motion happen? Well, unlike the moon and the sun, the Earth can overtake Mars in its orbit. So you see right here, right as Earth is overtaking Mars in the orbit, Mars appears to go backwards. And if you imagine yourself standing on this Earth, and if you play with this model for an hour like I did, and you imagine yourself standing on the Earth here and looking down this line of sight, then you can imagine superimposing over here how Mars would appear to go backwards. And after we pass it, we see that this little arc here will start going the other direction on the planet, and it'll appear to be moving forward again. Great. So this is probably one of my favorite things I've ever made in Mathematica, because I made this physical system here that is, you know, very, very, very simple. It's just things going around in circles, and then just projected it onto this, which is like literally a mathematical projection from linear algebra, not complicated, but true to the system at least, right? And then I played around with it until I found the retrograde motion here, what the Greeks saw. And then you can go back to this model and see what actually happened with the planets in the 3D model. And there's no hard coding of the behavior here. If I had, you know, coded this wrong, then retrograde motion wouldn't have popped up. But it's just that fundamental to the system that even with my very, very not to scale orbits and planet sizes here, you can still see this effect of retrograde motion. Okay, so I've made a whole bunch of physics things like this, which are on my website and on my GitHub, which is linked there, which you can download if you want to like play with the special relativity model or something like that. But that is the end of my visualization through Mathematica workshop. Recap, I showed you how to use Mathematica, what it's about, how it's connection to Wolfram Alpha, and then a bunch of things that it can do by scrolling through these lesson plans, and then an example of a physics thing, which is what I think is like the epitome of like what I was aiming for when I made this class of visualization through Mathematica. It's like visualizing physical systems like this. Okay, great, cool. So are there any questions? Cool. Okay. Well, if you ever make anything cool in Mathematica or want to know how to make something cool, you can shoot me an email. Let me just put that in here. And then if you want to see other things that students or see things that other students that took my class have made, that's on the course website, like a Pokemon battle simulator and a neuroscience like tour of the brain and stuff like that. Well, not stuff like that, stuff of that variability. Great. Okay. In that case, I guess so the organizers are here. Should I just end the meeting? Oh yeah, great. Thanks for attending. This was fun. Yeah, I enjoyed this too.